So just to get a little context on what we're doing here, perhaps if you'd be willing to just get comfortable for a moment, just let your body be upright and relaxed. And if you just let your eyes close just for a moment. So when your body relaxes, of course, your breathing also relaxes. And if, as much as you can, if you could cast your attention back to the earliest time in your life, as a human being, you were born into a situation of complete vulnerability. You couldn't walk, you couldn't hold up your head, you couldn't be more vulnerable. And this wasn't for a short time, for years. You were deeply dependent. And perhaps, if you can, just seeing if you can reconnect with how that felt, because I think you may find that's still accessible now. Now, very early on, you found that your only real protection in this very vulnerable state was your mother and perhaps your both of your parents. And very early on, most likely, you found that not everything you did was completely acceptable to your mother or to your parents. You started to realize that you weren't acceptable. That in order to get this protection that you absolutely had to have, you had to become manipulative. You had to become fake. And some people can remember back to this tension between being real, between being authentic, and being safe and protected. Some people can remember back to that getting set up, or to how this felt. You may even find within your body a physical tension that maps this situation that you had right from the earliest times when you were here. Some people say this is the primary spiritual problem that human beings have. This tension between being real, being authentic, being free, and being safe, being protected, being part of the group, part of the herd. Now, connecting with this in whatever way is most vivid for you, and then when you're ready, allowing your eyes to lift. So the book that Laz and I were involved in, together with a third contributor, we called Rough Waking for Those Confined and Homeless, Including You. And basically where it came from is a sense of this primary tension that we all tend to carry right from our earliest time on this planet. You can view the Adam and Eve story as a coded version of this. They're all right as long as they do exactly what God tells them to do and they're good little kids. As soon as they don't, as soon as they decide something for themselves, they're out. They're in the world of suffering. And so we have to navigate this. Now, this book that we've put together is a fundraiser and a consciousness raiser around a project we've been doing for some years now, working with people in the homelessness and prison spheres, in the areas of confinement and insecurity, if you like. And the reason I started off with our own individual situations to this, or relationship with this fundamental problem, is that how you deal with this internally, how we as a society deal with this internally, is what gets externalized, is what manifests in the way we treat those people within our society who, for whatever reason, have ended up either confined or in a condition of homelessness. Now, I want to talk a little bit more about that, but before I do, the book's divided into three sections, and the first part is Laz's journey. Laz is an artist, and amongst many other things, and I don't know how much you want to talk about how it happened, but basically Laz ended up living on the streets for a while.
Yeah, so it happened in 2012 when my childhood traumas caught up with me, and that was the second episode in my life. 2012 I got diagnosed with bipolar disorder, what I dubbed I have. I call it something else. I keep it to myself if you don't mind. And then I end up in a mental hospital, and I was sectioned too. And then when I get out, I get a flat, but I didn't feel comfortable in my flat, so I felt like I'm rather better off on the street. And then in 2014, I was always interested about spiritualism, yeah? And then in 2014, I started my journey with chanting first. Obviously, I did my research about Buddhism and went to Krishna farm and the church and all sorts of stuff. I tried to find my way. And I was always trying to reach out for something. And through chanting, I discovered something. So I discovered I can focus and I can sit still. And after a while, I felt like I didn't need to even chant. And I find meditation. And I didn't look further, because I truly believe in we have everything in ourselves.
Now, there's this particular situation you describe.
Yeah.
Are you willing to talk about that?
Yeah.
Were you crying and stuff?
What you?
And which part? The doctor said he won't help you, and then you did.
Yeah. So. And to be honest, the turning point for me was in that Christmas, when I had no received phone call from my family, from no friends, and I have a kind of a mental breakdown. It's how they call it in psychology. In spiritualism, they call it breakthrough. I went to a hospital in Sentence back in the days, and I asked the doctors to do the doctor to help me out, because I have a nervous breakdown. 3 or 4 days I was continuously crying and laughing and crying and laughing. A psychosis. And he said, okay, let me check your files. He went to check my files, came back one hour later. He tapped my shoulder. He said, don't worry, everything's gonna be fine. Just go home. That was the biggest help ever I get in my life. The reason why, because I realized everything depends on me. I can get support and help from health professionals, from people, from family, whatever I call it, friends, but everything what I can give to myself is within me. And that's why meditation for me is like a life-changing experience, because I learn a lot from silence. And why I learn a lot from silence? Because suffering made me turn into me, within. And from there,
so Laz has become an award-winning photographer, an amazing artist, and many, many other things. Yeah. But the big question, particularly being right here, you know, where it's all around us so much, so many people ask me, and I'm guessing, you know, there may be people here who want to know, when you see somebody who's on the street, who's calling for help, what would you do? What advice would you give to people?
How should we relate? I mean, I see myself in them. So if I see a drug addict, I see myself in that drug addict. If I see a homeless, I see myself in that person. To be honest, as I see the world, you know, sometimes we respect ourselves and respect our family. My question is, who is in my family? Because in the end of the day, as I see, my home is planet Earth, and my nationality, I'm a human. So that person is a part of my family, somehow, because everything is connected, I truly believe in. But I don't know, feel sometimes the society is very egocentric and materialistic, and you forget about those people. And I relate to those people. I don't relate to them anymore emotionally, because that's gonna have a negative impact on me. But since then, to be honest, these days I work for NHS as a mental health peer coach, and I try to do my best for every single person who needs my help. And can I ask you to do anything or think about them, because everybody has their own view and own think about homeless people and homelessness. Try to see them as you see yourself.
And what do you recommend to do?
What I recommend to do? I don't recommend anything. It needs to come from your heart, I truly believe in. Yeah. Please don't get me wrong, I'm not giving advices, because all I know is nothing and I'm nobody, yeah? So you will feel what you need to do. That's it.
Thanks, Laz. So we got some photos and Laz's story in the book. Mm. The third person who isn't here in the book is a Japanese man called Kazuaki Okazaki, who back in the 80s, as a young guy, got pulled into a very, very dark sort of brainwashing cult in Japan called Omshinrikyo. He ended up getting involved in a murder that this was involved with this cult, and as a result of that, he ended up on death row in Japan, and he was hanged just under a year ago, July last year. So he was on death row for a little bit over a decade, and during that time, he kind of turned his life around, and he reached out to my teacher, who's a Zen master in Japan called Shinzan. And so while the legal process was going on, my teacher used to go and visit Okazaki in prison. Now, once your death sentence is formally ratified, then under the Japanese prison system, you're only allowed to be visited by members of your family. So at that point, my teacher adopted Okazaki as his son. And so Okazaki had this period of about 12 years, which he had basically made into a retreat. He started to practice Zen meditation, and he started to really try to make amends in every way that he could for the pain and the suffering that he'd caused. And he also, like Laz, had a very strong artistic dimension. He created a series of images that we have in the book that basically kind of reflect a spiritual journey, they're sort of the steps on a spiritual journey. Is this one here, I don't know if you can see, you've got a crane dancing with another crane. A crane's kind of like a heron, quite a, you know, widespread bird in East Asia. And the image of a crane dancing with a crane is a sort of an image of congratulation, an image of celebration, an image of two becoming one. Now, in terms of the spiritual journey that he kind of depicts, the two coming together is basically about the sort of the individual, if you like, coming into a relationship where they're, as it were, dancing with the universe. When you learn, even within the strictest confinement, where every morning when you wake up, you don't know if it's going to be your last day, it's possible to learn to dance with the universe, to find the place where this insecurity and this limitation on our freedom that gets sort of stuck in very, very early in life can actually be transcended, can actually be dealt with. And that's sort of what he's kind of depicting in his sort of sequence of images in the book. Now, the Zen language for dealing with this, for actually finding the kind of the resolution of this tension between insecurity and confinement and conformity, is narikiru. So nari, the Japanese term nari, means to become. Kiru, in this context, means kind of like totally, 100%, with nothing left over. When we utterly face our situation, our predicament, however impossible it is, when we're, as it were, one with that suffering, with that pain, with that situation, something extraordinary happens. I've been recently looking into Dante, who's kind of the great Western expounder of the spiritual journey in many ways. So Dante goes on this great journey deeper and deeper and deeper into hell. He goes down these rings of hell, right to the kind of the core, right to the center, where, you know, right in the middle, it's frozen. It's frozen solid, and there's Satan frozen in the middle of it. And then what does he do? Does he come back up out again? No, he carries straight on. He goes right through the middle. And through that, he escapes. He comes out of hell. He comes on to the next stage in his journey. When we are willing to absolutely face our vulnerability, our confinement, our constraints on our freedom, our liberation, and the tensions and pains that have been set up in most cases so early in life, when we can confront these things and be with them utterly, we come through. We find a kind of a liberation. We find a rough waking. Okay, and any other route, I think, it's been 30 years I've been in this business, any other route, as far as I can tell so far, seems to lead to essentially another layer of suffering rather than coming through, kind of resolving what was there. So in many ways that's sort of what we're pointing out with the book as much as we can. So the book's basically a fundraiser. All the people involved with it are contributing their time, their effort, their energy, their creativity to our work with people who are in the homelessness and in the prison spheres. Our little motto kind of going over the top of our work is change your body, change your mind, change your life. We've been working with the St. Giles Trust, who are a charity who are sort of dedicated to the prison and homelessness realms, and done some amazing work in that field. And we've been about 5 years working with them, and we're looking to do more. So through buying the book, you're sponsoring and supporting all of that. And I hope also, you know, potentially finding some value in your own journey as well. So we got Laz in the book. We've got Okazaki's work, and then I've spent about 30 years in Zen monasteries and so on, and my teacher in Japan, Shinzan, who I mentioned before, used to sort of joke, really, that Zen life is a combination of prison and homelessness. And that's kind of one of the reasons this all sort of came together the way it did, writing poems here and there. And I wanted to read you just a couple of ones that you know, perhaps reflect my little bit in the book. So the first one's called Contraflow. Before I cut my hair, I drove 1,000 miles a week. Each day counted down in road signs, the English working man in his white line samadhi. And the fuel in my tank was hope. Hope for the life of a country monk, cloud-free, open as water. Now, for 7 years, I've barely left this valley, seeking the mind that abides nowhere. Finding a road running through this body, traffic thundering, returning home. So when we turn the light around, as they call it in Zen, then we can potentially find that. But basically when we do, typically what we face, what we find first, is the rough stuff. There's reasons why we're not all completely, you know, liberated from day one. This one's called Nigredo, which is the phase in alchemy when everything goes black. The phase in our inner alchemy, our inner transformation. Night, blackness, into my worn brain, stars hammer their nails, the moon's sickle cuts me down. I'll lie here till the frost grips me fast, and at dawn a rook swoops to gouge out my eyes. Released, my pale spirit could wander the grey in search of a heart where hope still beats. So it can get a little bit kind of rough, and so there's always this possibility to turn around, to walk away, to avoid. And the amazing thing is, most of us do, most of the time, but if we come back again, we can carry on. And, you know, in many cases it's fits and starts, but if we carry on, if we keep on getting up, coming back, then things change.
I think suffering is a big part of change.
Yeah.
Because when you're sick and tired to being sick and tired, it will make you change. And so many people, as I tried many, many things in my life, as I said, I went to Krishna Farm, Buddhist temple, whatever it is. Really, when you turn within and you try to find your answer inside, I think silence teaches you more and suffering teaches you more than anything else.
Yeah, yeah, I'm with you there, right, yeah. So, last one, and then maybe we can do some discussion, questions, anybody got any points? It's called Invitation. I shed, one by one, my clothes and walk naked into the friendly dark, and the dark embraces me. Deeper I walk, deeper than shadow, and in the darkest place dances a fountain. At this place of miracles, I have everything except a friend. Will you, won't you, come?
What made you want to live in a Zen monastery? What happened in your life that made you turn again and leave the world behind?
Well, you know, it's hard to track it back, really. And I'm a little bit suspicious of making up stories and so on, but as far as I've sort of found so far, I reckon it was about, I was a Cold War kid. I grew up in Kent in the sort of 60s, 70s and so on, and my dad used to play squash with the guys in the local army camp, and I can remember as a pretty tiny kid, him coming back with stories that any time they wanted, the Russians could be across Europe in 24 hours, and they could be across the Channel and through the UK in another couple of days. And the only way we could stop basically that happening was to press the button. And this kind of got in very deeply, I think. And there was a strong sense of fear, and also a strong sense of urgency, that life was very likely to be quite short. And so that really went deep. And so by the time I was 25, I'd been through the education thing, I'd done a little bit of the career stuff, I could look round, I could see that guy, that's me in 10 years, that's me in 20 years, all that stuff, you know. And it was like, well, what am I really gonna do now? And what's really important? And at the time, this seemed to be, for me, the most worthwhile thing. So 25, I sold the house, gave all the money away, and jumped into this kind of nonsense. It seems to me, you know, and I've been back in London for 12 years now, so I've sort of met a lot of people kind of exploring deeply, really. And it seems to me I'm seeing basically three types of people, you know, or three primary motivations. There's people who have, you know, had a straight out and out rough time, whatever that, you know, however that particularly has manifested for them. And then I'm seeing what on the surface is almost the opposite. People who are coming and they say to me, you know, I've got like the perfect family, I've got my dream job, you know, I've got beautiful kids, but surely there must be more. This can't be it. You know what I mean? There's that sort of disquiet. So in a sense, it comes down to the same thing, I think, although it looks ostensibly opposite. And then the third type of person is the person who, for whatever reason, it's like the curtain is drawn aside for a moment or two, and they see a potential, and it's like, oh, so there's that going on. And then they want to, you know, they've lost it or whatever, or they want to reconnect with that, and then they come too. So you could view all of those, in a sense, as different forms of suffering, I suppose, different forms of disquiet. You want to?
Yeah. I think if you think about the story of Buddha, yeah, he has everything, yeah?
Right.
And then he went out, he sees old people and ill people and sick people and people dying. So he wanted to discover what it's all about. So that's his story. But if you think about Eckhart Tolle, yeah, he was suffering. So he wanted to kill himself many, many times. And one time he was sitting on a park bench in London, as I remember, and he just, this is what he said, he just became enlightened. He was sitting on a park bench as a homeless for almost 2 years. Yeah, so I have a different story, and I truly believe in this body is my carrier, yeah, and I have a soul. So probably in my previous life, a soul wasn't ready for this changing, and now, at the age of 44, I'm there. So I don't think you necessarily need to suffer in order to find yourself within.
There are others who've been struggling for 30, 40 years, banging and banging and banging, nothing's opening, no master has appeared, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
so maybe it's in their karma, you go through with it. So maybe by, you know what I mean?
It's, yeah. Do you heard about the cycle of change?
Yeah, yeah.
So the cycle of change starts, you need to admit what is your problem, what's wrong with you. Some people in denial. Because being in denial is much easier for them,
that's
you know,
right,
instead of admit the problems, yeah? And to admit the problems, it takes a lot of courage and responsibility as well also. And don't think I wasn't in denial back in the days, because I have problem with cocaine addiction. And so many people come to me and told me, Laz, you're going down, man. You just became a really arrogant and aggressive towards everyone. And you, all the money you work for, really hard for, you know, you spend it on cocaine. And I said, you know what, when I have a few lines, and don't get me wrong, I'm not, you know, advocating cocaine here, yeah? But when I have a few lines, I close my eyes and I feel I'm loved. Mm-hmm. And I love myself. And I like it, because it's the first time in my life and I feel true love. But I realized after that true love wasn't true love. It was a fake love, yeah? And after a while, I realized, you know what I need. Which just turns me in without cocaine. or any other substances.
I suppose with drugs and that, it's a quick spiritual trip for people. They're not willing to sit and meditate or follow teachings or whatever.
Yeah.
Some people, they're so fed up, that's a quick way,
kind
of religious experience.
Exactly.
You know? Yeah.
I can trip these days with breathing techniques because my lungs release a lot of DMT, so... I can trip without those stuff, and I don't have a depression after that. Although, don't think, sometimes I'm not depressed, sometimes I don't feel sadness, sometimes I don't feel angry, because in the end of the day, I'm a human, and we have four basic emotions, fear, anger, sadness, and happiness. Yeah? And you know what? I welcome my depression. I welcome my anger. But it's not about, what's happening with me, but how I react. How I react, when I wake up in the morning and I feel the depression in my chest, middle of my chest, I say, there you go again. 44 years wasn't enough for you to kill me. It's not going to happen today. And I just get out from the bed and I carry on with the day.
I was actually fed by a bottle by my three-year-old sister, because my mother didn't really like children. So I was fed out of duty, and my sister didn't really want to feed me anyway. So I've grown up without that, having to be fake. And it means that I'm not loyal to a company. You know the company ethic, I'm just not loyal to it. I don't feel I have to be. And do you agree with that? I'm just very interested in that meditation, so can you speak a little bit more about it?
Well, it's a very interesting situation where that kind of happens. It's exactly the story, going back to Laz's point there, it's exactly the story of the Buddha. The Buddha's mother died during childbirth. So he was brought up in a very, it seems very a privileged situation, but probably everybody around him was basically a courtier, were paid to be there. And so he also didn't, almost certainly he didn't need to, as it were, earn his protection. But at the same time, that still didn't work, you could make the case that his ability to attach got affected. So mid-20s, basically he walks out on his young child, he walks out on his wife, he walks out on his responsibilities. He's the heir apparent for this little country that's rather struggling because it's got very hostile neighbors. He's kind of like the ultimate dropout, really. And then he has to kind of go from there. He's got his own version, his own journey, facing all of that and coming through all of that to seemingly become a person who's able to be a benefit to others. I think you can trace some very early life stuff there that probably marked the journey very strongly. I went to India and I was very interested in meditation. And so up in the north, I went up into Ladakh, and that's basically ethnically Tibetan, at least the bit that I was in. But it was very, very cold. And nobody ever cleaned anything. So in the temples, the moment you touched anything, you just got coated in black. And this really put me off. I don't know what it is. I don't think I'm a clean freak. For whatever reason, that just didn't do it. And then I went to Southeast Asia and explored a little bit over there. And I remember down in Thailand, I met this monk, this young guy in super duper bright fluorescent orange robe. And I think he was wanting to practice his English a bit, he came up for a lecture. And I said to him, how long, I didn't know a lot of this, but I said to him, how long does it take before you get enlightened? And he said, nobody gets enlightened, only the Buddha was enlightened. And so that kind of put me off that one. Yeah. So then, after this sort of wandering about a little bit, it just so happened, I was living in Newcastle on Tyne at the time, it just so happened in literally the next street to where I was living, there was a Zen meditation group meeting every week. And so, a friend of mine hooked me up with them, and it was like, ah, okay, this works. So it was kind of like that, really, for me. Yeah. So if any of you guys are Londoners and you want a little you know, you're interested to explore on the practice side a bit more. We have a dojo down a little bit beyond the Oval, you know, down in South London. You're very welcome to come by. Our website's called zenways.org. It's got all the info on.
And you save a lot of money because you don't need to go to Tibet and Japan.
Yeah, right. True enough. Yeah, come to South London. Yeah, it's a shorter and cheaper spiritual journey. You're right. Yeah. Coming out.